54 participants.
Yes. Good evening and welcome to all the veterinarians and pet practitioners across India. Vetina welcomes you all for a series of educational webinar where in today's topic is advances in orthopedic surgery and the latest treatment for osteoarthritis. With the advent of increasing demand of surgical treatment, we also bring to you a complete solution for veterinary needs wherein we share the information about treatment for osteoarthritis. To start with, we will first know in brief about our today's speaker, Dr. Milind Hatekar. Dr. Milind Hatekar is a Master of Veterinary Science, having experience of 30 years in small animal surgery and studies. He has worked in US, Germany, and France. He is also the founder member of Veterinary Orthopedic Foundation, conducting educational conferences and workshops at regular intervals to upgrade the veterinary professionals. He is the owner of the Pet Aid Animal Small Animal Clinic, having multiple branches in India, Qatar, and Doha. We welcome Dr. Hatekar.
Hi, good evening. Can I share my screen?
Yes, sir. You can share the screen.
So today's topic we are discussing is advances in orthopedic and treatment of osteoarthritis. So over a period of time, in 10 years time, I feel that there is a marked change in the orthopedic scenario all over India. And since we started conducting the seminars, the conferences and webinars, a lot of awareness has come up. And a lot of pharmaceutical companies are also responsible for changing the scenario because new products have been introduced by a lot of companies for aiding and helping the joint treatment. And overall, the quality of life of the patients have improved by using these products. And definitely, the veterinarians are the most people, the responsible people who are aiding into diagnosis of a disease and diagnosis, treatment, and doing the follow-up of the patient and see how the is either the disease is progressing or the quality of life of the patient is improving. So definitely, I should thank the whole all of the veterinarians of India for changing their mode of thinking and the attitude changing towards the patient and the owner. You know, it's very, very important to satisfy any owner coming to you. Basically, why it is important, I feel, because unless and until the owner is not happy with you, even if you are educated, you have diagnosed the disease very well, you have treated the disease very well, you have to always keep the owner happy, which is by communication. And I feel most of the veterinarians in India are not communicating well with the client. The client communication is so very important for all of us by sharing and talking to the owner about the disease condition, explaining them properly. And whenever you take a radiograph, just don't keep the knowledge of the radiograph with yourself. So you should bring the client in front of a radiograph, explain each and every, whatever you see on the radiograph, whether it's bone disease or heart disease or whatever you're dealing with. Like, so when you explain the radiograph to a client or a CT, if you've done a CT and the client has spent so much of money, you stand in front of the screen and explain him, spend time, let the animal be there. And on the animal, you can show that the disease process is in this particular area. And once you explain it, your job becomes much easier. So always explain a condition, find time. If you're seeing like 20 patients in 1 hour, don't do that, because ultimately what will happen, people will switch on to other people saying that this veterinarian is too busy, doesn't have time. So whenever you're doing an orthopedic consult, you can always charge a little higher to the client, because the client will be ready to pay for your time, in fact. And orthopedic consults are not just done on the table. I'd like to always advise people, like, take the dog out and make the dog walk, because you can't diagnose lameness on a table. Your dog has to walk. When you say lame, it is the dog is not able to walk properly. So if you don't walk the dog properly, just don't end up your treatment on the table without, if the owner says that my dog is limp and is limping on that particular leg, just don't give painkillers and just stop the conversation there, because there is some underlying disease which you have not diagnosed and somebody else diagnoses it, and then you are in a soup because you ultimately lose the client. So nicely walk the dog right in front of you first, away from you, at least 50 steps away from you, then walking towards you, and pay full attention when you do a examination or the walking examination, when you're watching at the limbness. So there'll be head bobbing, there'll be favoring of that particular leg. So these dogs, when they walk, they give you symptoms of the disease, in fact. So those symptoms are very important to find out. So once you do the dog, and then you should also walk the dog in circles, once in anti-clockwise, stand in the center, make the dog walk in clockwise and anti-clockwise direction, and see, these are mainly when you are examining the stifle joint and the hip joint. So whenever the dog is walking inwards on the inner side, when he's walking clockwise, there will be more pressure. If he's going from clockwise, there will be more pressure on the left hand side, left of the left hind limb, or the left shoulder joint. So you'll be able to markedly find out where the problem is. You know, I'm not able to change my slide.
Sir, you can just click on the slide and then...
Okay, yes. I got it. Yeah.
Yes.
So now the new thing that are coming is more and more veterinarians are using diagnostic methods like arthroscopy, CT scan, and MRI imaging. So the imaging process has completely transformed in cities mainly, and even in smaller cities, if you don't have, you can always speak to your human doctors. We have collaboration with two or three places in Pune where they welcome us for doing the CT scans and MRI. They charge you extra, but end result is very good, that the patient is being benefited. And once the patient is being benefited, more people want to, they'll come and say, I want to do a CT, I want to do a MRI. Can we do a MRI? Can we do a CT? And if you are not aware of this, you can contact a veterinarian in a city who is doing specialized orthopedic surgeries and get it done through him or by his team, in fact. Arthroscopy is coming up very rampantly in India, very rapidly in India. Generation kids are coming, the new vets, not the kids, I should say. And they have got beautiful toys, in fact. I've seen so many new clinics starting up with so many diagnostic aids, what they've got. They got x-rays, they got a fluoroscopy, they're getting ultrasound. And it's fabulous to see the changing scenario in India. In fact, we are rapidly growing than the other neighboring countries. Definitely Thailand and Hong Kong and all are much progressive, they're progressing very fast because their economic status was much better than us. But eventually we are getting into that. Another thing is like once you have the CT scan, you can get into 3D printing. So 3D printing is, 3D printing, what they do, they put the CT scan on a 3D printer, and the 3D printer can print a bone, a defective bone, where you can actually see the bone, which is replicating the dog's bone inside his muscles. So this bone will be exact replica of the deformities which are formed in the dog. So, and you can plan the surgery and you can explain the owner that, see, this is a problem with the dog, and we need to do a corrective surgery like this. And it works very fabulous. So I have cited out a patient here. Her name is Lemon. And we took help of, we did a CT scan initially. And there is one guy called as Mr. Gala, who runs a business for 3D printing and pre-planning of surgery for human patients. And this guy has done such a fabulous job. We wanted to do surgery with one of my friend in Italy and along my German friend. And we are still planning to do once we are a little better with the COVID. So I'll show you the patient how she walks. So here's a lemon. She's a collie they got it at the age of 2 months. And at the age of 2 months, she started limping on her leg. And just watch her video. And now she's 1 year and she's been carrying this disease for almost a year now. So see how the left leg is deviated and she's hopping on the leg. And if you watch closely, the stifle is angulated. That's on the left side. So now check out. It's deviated so much. It is almost like 25 to 30 degrees external rotation in this leg. So this is these are the images which are created from CT, and this was used for planning. You see there is a hip dysplasia on the right hand side, and there is a 45 degree rotation of the hip joint, and you see how the stifle has come out here. So the stifle has come out very badly out, and there's a lot of external rotation. The whole joint has moved outward. And there is a small fracture, which evidently none of the preliminary vets who saw her on the X-ray would make it out. So there was a fracture which happened when the dog was around 2 months or 3 months. And what happened initially when the client went to the vet, the dog was limping, and the preliminary vet did not do a radiograph and just kept him on painkiller, some multivitamins and glucosamine condroitin sulfate, and they went home. And again, after 1 month, the people came with the same complaint that the dog is limping. So there was a fracture in the epiphysis in this area, which wrongly healed. And now it is there's a deviation of the patella. I can show you in the next slide here. So there is a deviation of patella here, and there is a 40 to 45 degrees rotation, external rotation of the femoral head. So I'm discussing this case to show you that how 3D printing and imaging helps to diagnose it. So they have printed a bone, the bone looks exactly the way we see on the CT scan. So the planning, and they also tell you where to cut. So they make a jig, and you have to just put a jig on that and make exactly the calculated by the computer or the software what they are using for correcting. It's called as the corrective osteotomy, what they're going to do. So we are going to change the patellar groove there, we are going to do a corrective osteotomy by trying to rotate the leg, almost bringing it to 25 degrees. You can't do a correction of 45 degrees because the muscles are already, the quadriceps muscles pull is there, and the dog is already walking in a wrong manner, and there's too much of stretching. So what happens when there is a deformity, the body wants to compensate it. The body wants to bring it to normal or make the dog's life comfortable. So there is extra stretching of muscles. So when you do the corrective osteotomy, the muscles go like haywire. They're not able to understand. So when you correct the bone, the muscles are already rotated in a different direction. They're squeezed. They're squeezed like this here. So there's a rotation of the muscles. And when you try to correct it, it will definitely take time for it to come back to normal. So this dog will need a lot of physiotherapy. Will need a lot of physiotherapy post-surgery. So this if you see that there's a rotation, as I told you, in the there is hip dysplasia on the right hand side and left side. Already I discussed how it is. So we have to do this two surgeries now, and later on we'll do the hip replacement. By that time, I think in 1 or 2 years we should have someone who has done a replacement course and got even enough experience. So now a lot of people are in arthroscopic interventions. They are catching up very fast, and the investment is little high initially. But when you buy arthroscope and start using it, these toys really mystify you when you use them. You can literally look into the joint very clearly. The images are very promising. You see here how the scope is introduced. And this needs a specialized training. But if you look and go and walk around with people who are already doing arthroscopy, my advice would be like, don't jump and buy arthroscope, because you have seen people using it, but go for training, get yourself well trained, and then invest into arthroscopy, because it's a very specialized branch and you have to know the anatomy of the joint very well. You should know where the ligaments are there, where the meniscus are there, which tendon is going to move from there. What are you going to look into a normal joint and an abnormal joint? So a lot of training has to be there, but it's a fabulous tool. And once you start using it, you can literally look into the joint and see the meniscal tear, or when you're doing a stifle, you can see the ACL tear in the joint. So it's very important to do the training basically when you start doing any scopy as such. Most of the people with the arthroscope, they have different scopes which can be used for laparoscopes and which can be used for cystoscopy. You can use for bronchoscopy. Only the length of the scope changes, and the functionality of that scope also changes along with that. So if you're investing in arthroscopy, don't think that you can do only arthroscopy. So you can do rhinoscopy. You can literally go and look into the esophagus. It's a rigid scope. So when you're doing when you're going in the esophagus, you can go to the stomach in small dogs. But the rotation and the capability is more better in an endoscope than a normal scope or a rigid scope what you're using. So arthroscopes are very small scopes, and they are just meant to go in the joint, and you can use a 30-degree scope to look into the joint, because it gives you a better visibility with arthroscope. You can do scopy of the shoulder joint in dogs. You can do the stifles. You can do the elbows in that. If you're doing very small, tiny dogs, then we have to get very tiny scopes for that. So, which are very delicate, and you have to be, whenever you're maneuvering it, you have to be very careful that you're not pressurizing or bending the scopes, which will destroy the angulation of the scope as such. So you can use for examination of shoulders for tendonitis and some other like OCD, you can use it. And when you put a arthroscope inside, you can, from a different port, you can use a working port, it is called as, which can help you to remove the damaged tissue, which is, this is like a small instrument which has been put in to remove the parts of the of OCD in a shoulder joint. So these are nice things with the arthroscope. You can go inside and then later on remove the whatever the degenerative changes are there in the joint, scoop them off. You can use a rimmer, a bone rimmer, to rim off the damaged menisci or the joint surface. And then there are a lot of new things which have come in, and then you can inject in the joint and do the resurfacing of the joint also. And when you are doing TPLO, you can get into the joint with a scope and remove the broken cruciate ligament, the remnants of a cruciate ligament with the scope. So what happens when you go with the arthroscope, you are not opening the whole of the joint. So the chances of infection in the joint are less with the arthroscope. And it's a minimal invasive technique, which really helps to go through a small windows and do your job and get out. And then you can do the major surgery of a TPL or like a tibial plateau leveling. So these are the new fields and new techniques, like I would like for people to use more and more in their practice. Fluoroscopy has also done a marked change. 10 years back, I never used, I used to see fluoroscopy being done everywhere, but it took me almost 10 years to evolve to buy a fluoroscope and get into the fluoroscopy. And I then understood that how important fluoroscopy is in orthopedic surgery and diagnosing different diseases with you can even diagnose the breathing pattern, how the dog breathes, and if there is a tracheal prolapse, you can literally see how the trachea is collapsed on all. So I mainly use in orthopedics for whenever I'm going in a bone, going with a K-wire. As I told you, we use more MIPO now, minimal invasive techniques for doing fracture repairs, because since in fluoroscopy, you can see where exactly you're going, where your pin is heading towards. Are you getting out of the bone, or you're in the plane with the bone? So this is very important. So this is a fluoroscopy image, what I'm showing you, and you can see the how the movement of the joint, shoulder joint is there. And you can literally see how the joint is moving. And then in the meantime, if you watch here, you can see the trachea also, and you can see how the dog also breathes. So fluoroscopy is getting evolved more and more. And they've come up with like a four-dimensional fluoroscopy, where you can see how the dog walks exactly when you do a stifle surgery. So you can look at the stifle before the surgery and after the surgery, means how, to what extent your surgery has really helped in. So there was this same aid was used to compare TTA, that TTA is another stifle surgery over TPLO. And then they found that the TPLO was much better, because the joint stability is better in TPLO rather than in TTA. So this is a hip joint. What you see, how the hip is moving. Then you can see the stifle here. Then you can also just zoom in and just concentrate on one single joint and try to move. So this is a dog who is literally standing in a scope, in a big machine, and they are monitoring his joint movements. So a lot of people are using MRI, which is a fantastic technique, I feel. Only thing, you should be able to read them properly. Just don't do MRI for fancy, like a dog is coming in and limping, and then you say that, oh, let's do an MRI. I've seen a lot of vets doing that, and the end result is that they're not able to read the MRI properly. Because most of the MRIs are done in the human facility. So first, what you do, always take a history, understand why the dog is limping. Because in some dogs, since I've started practicing in Qatar, a lot of people come for orthopedic consult where they had some underlying disease, like a dog might have suffered from a tick fever and he's limping. So taking history is so important, and every aspect of the history. In fact, you should make a case paper and try to take at least 15 minutes. If you don't have time, you can train a nurse doing it, or train a student, a veterinary student. Try taking a lot of veterinary students in your practice, because you people can give them opportunity to learn. So a lot of people feel that these people will come and learn with you and create a competition. And life, for me, I don't consider competition at all for this. In fact, you are generating better vets and sharing knowledge, in fact. So it hurts when people come with you, work with you, to gain experience and leave from you. But it's always for their betterment of life, and they'll always be thankful to you for teaching what you have already taught them in your practice. And these are the things of which we are going to get carry forward. I would like to advise, if we have any professors here, that you share your knowledge with the children. And if you are running a private practice along with your teachings, try to involve the students in your practice and let them learn and see as many as cases coming to you. Because unfortunately, our colleges are still not moving ahead with the private practitioners. The private practitioners are growing faster with better knowledge, and they're gathering knowledge from outside. And we, our institutes are still getting stagnated of knowledge, and we are still using the old notes which are 50 years back. I'm not criticizing anybody here, but I would like to tell the professors that please go and read more and new knowledge. There are so many courses happening on webinar, and they're free courses. Spend some time. Your job as a teacher is it's a very responsible job, because you are going to create a person, a vet with a better knowledge and a better depth of knowledge only because you have taught him. So coming back to this, we diagnose like many diseases like osteochondrosis. Then we can diagnose elbow dysplasia. Then we can diagnose stifle problems, ruptured ACL tears in the joint. In orthopedics and in neurosurgeries, MRIs and CT scans have played a very vital role. And we use a lot of contrast studies when you are doing the spinal studies, in fact. So before I forget, let me tell you that when you consider any joint, it is made up of a concave and a convex surface. So like the hip joint is a ball and socket joint. If you look at the vertebrae, if you get a chance to observe the alignment of two vertebrae, if you look at the cranial end of one vertebra and caudal end of one vertebra, other vertebra, you see there's a concavity and a convexity. So even the vertebrae are small joints with very little movement in them. And even osteoarthritis is set in this joint. So whenever you are considering an old dog and they're limping, so don't consider that only this dog has any joint problems, but they can be spondylosis in the vertebrae, because as I told you, these are also small joints, and they also have your discs are the protecting like a menisci in the stifle joint or the other joints. So consider that factor also. You can also consider look on the X-ray if the osteophytes are growing there, because if there is a nerve pinching, if the nerve is pinched with the degenerative joint disease or in IVD, intervertebral disc disease, which is again a old age disease, and because of old age, the osteophytes start developing and they pinch the nerve. So whenever the nerve pinching is there, there will be pain. So you have to identify the neurological pain from an orthopedic pain. So whether the pain is arising from the bone itself or it is from the pinching of the nerves. So you should always look into that and try to compare and scratch your head and take help of your friends. And if you have a group practice, it's better to examine like two, three people, two, three vets, observing the patient from different angle. And then if you're a senior, then you can ask questions to them. And their answers also sometimes help to diagnose the disease. Because if you are practicing, managing a large practice, then the time for a lot of thoughts are there in your mind, and you have to read the X-ray, attend this phone call, attend a VIP patient. So always share your responsibilities, because sharing responsibilities is for the betterment of your own practice. So share your responsibilities and try to have involve a lot of people for understanding a disease process. And if you're not able to diagnose it, you don't have to straight away tell the client that, this is the disease. For just to make the clients happy, you can say always that I can, even today I do that I tell the client that give me some time, I'll get back to you definitely. I'll tell you what exactly is wrong with what the dog. And then you can have a group discussion, look at the X-rays, look at the CT, look at the MRI when you are when you are into at leisure time. So ultrasound is another diagnostic aid which a lot of vets have been just using to do the ultrasound of the abdomen, but it is fast catching up with orthopedic surgeons and even in general practice. If you have a machine, start using it. If you see a joint inflamed, why don't you just put the probe on the joint? Like if my joint is swollen, if I'm a dog and my joint is swollen like this, I'm going to just use my probe there. I'm going to use my probe and just scan my joint and look at the screen, what is happening there. Because just scanning and ultrasound, you don't have to invest anything. You have to just invest one time. The machine is already there in the practice. Why not look for everything which looks swollen through ultrasound? It gives you so many, it can teach you so many things. Like you have a cat with a swollen joint and when you want to look into that, just run a probe and just stick in a needle. Mainly the cats will have a lot of cat bite abscesses in the joint and the joint looks very swollen and the cats will be limp and then they're referred to orthopedic surgeon for saying that it's an orthopedic case. So it's always good because it's you are adding to the value you're adding to the your diagnosis. It's a great valuable tool, in fact. So when you are holding the probe, ask one of the assistant to put stick in the needle in the joint and aspirate the joint and then study the fluid what you got. And if you see some pus or some blood in that, send it for culture and sensitivity. And you can also do the cytology of a joint. You can look at the thickness of the synovial fluid. You can run the protein content of the synovial fluid. Because infected joint and septic joints are very, very common, which are because of continuous irritation or cat bite wound, dog bite wound. And once you put on an antibiotic, course of antibiotic, and you have a culture and sensitivity report, it really works pretty well. You can look into the by looking into the brachial plexus. You can look at the soft tissue swelling masses and definitely peripheral tissues also. We did a study when there was a postgraduate students doing research on stem cells, and we used ultrasound guided stem cell injections in the hip joint with dogs with osteoarthritis. So we got so well trained, like once we did like 4 to 5 dogs, we were able to just put a probe so properly once we shaved the dog and on the hip joint, like you can literally see the hip joint so clearly. So you can see the how on the elbow would look like this when you put a probe. The images are so good. And the ultrasound will always, the bones will always look white because it will reflect how you see the stones in the bladder. They look all white and they reflect a black image over there. So you can correspond those images and look into you have to do many images for learning it. You can just take one dog. If you have a dog on your own, you can just calm and quiet dog. You can just put him on a table and start doing ultrasound of his joints. And you can be a learner for yourself, in fact, for looking on the YouTube or videos you can see and put the probe. You have to play around. It's your own machine. It's your own time. So just you just decide that you want to study one joint today and then we just move the probe all over the joint and see what's happening in the joint. If it is how a normal joint will look, and save the images and then compare the images with. And I'm very sure once you start doing it, you'll be automatically getting a lot of patients because you will start looking at patients which have joint inflamed joints, inflamed phalanges, inflamed shoulder joints, hip joints, stifle joints. So this is a very nice way of self-studies where you can train your eyes for looking into that. So here you can look medial collateral ligament and then you can look at the medial coronoid processes of the ulna. So as I told you, you can also get normal bones. If you there are suppliers who supply artificial bones, or even if you know that some people are burying dead dogs, whose business are to bury dead dogs, you can ask them to excavate a dog and get some bones and clean up and keep to explain to the client. Because when you explain the client the anatomy of the bone, looking at the bones what you have from dead dogs, it is amazingly the understanding of the client goes so well. You hold the bone, hold the x-ray and show the comparison with that. The client will be so happy because he knows where the problem exactly is, and the doctor is able to locate it. End of the day, you should be happy, the client should be happy. Money will automatically come. So don't run after money by just doing too many investigations, and don't do very high-end investigations which can be fixed by small things. I'd like to always tell clients who have, the veterinarians who have invested a lot of money in their practice, and ultimately you will make money eventually, but don't try to just jump into that. You want to get your money back. So don't try to rip off your clients, because ultimately you will earn bad name. So I've seen a lot of people doing that, I hate doing that, and I'll advise you to just go slowly. What can be diagnosed for some rupees, don't make it like 10,000 or 20,000 rupees for the same diagnosis. And give a frank opinion that this is my opinion. So opinions are like there can be many opinions of various people, and you give your straightforward opinion. A straightforward opinion is a straightforward opinion, because whether the client may like it or doesn't like it, it is his choice. And you can always tell that, in my opinion, I'm saying that this. And you can always make a guarded opinion if you're not very firm about your opinion. So, but make an opinion. Don't just let it go and say, I don't know what is happening to your dog. It's not going to help. So OCD can be diagnosed very well. Osteochondrodesiccans, which is again a developmental disease in a lot of young dogs, what we see. So whenever you get these limping dogs, always run an ultrasound and see what you can see. You should be able to see nice, and as I told you, the convex and the concave surfaces without any erosions on that. OCD is generally seen mainly in the humeral joint, the shoulder joint here. So whenever you see the joint with the OCD, you will see that there is a destruction of the bony surface here. And if you put an arthroscope, you can clearly see the images on that. And most of the people, when they do the ultrasound first and do the arthroscopy, they have found that whatever the images they found on the ultrasound were correlating with the your arthroscopy images. So once you are good with the ultrasound, it's a very cheap technique. You don't have to invest much in that. And if you want to, there are a lot of contrasts which have come in ultrasound also, which are which produces the joint can get little much bigger. And you can study the surfaces of the joint. I don't recollect the name of the contrast, what they use. They inject in the joint surface in a septic condition. Because you should not, whenever you're going in a joint, you have to be very, you have to follow the rules that you have to be very sterile and use new needles and be very particular, shave the joint properly. You have to clean the joint with chlorhexidine, then betadine, and then get into the joint. Don't just jump into the joint without doing any cleansing, because aseptic conditions are very important, because you will end up into having joint issues by putting more infection in the joint. So the pathogenesis is well defined problem and is always a half solved thing. So osteoarthritis is the most common form of arthritis in dogs, which is eventually, unfortunately, I'll call that is a getting a lifestyle disease like human beings. happened over a period of time, our patients are getting more restricted from their movement. And since they're getting restriction of movement, less exercise, I see a lot of arthritis going in numbers day by day. And I feel that we ourselves are responsible, not ourselves, means the owner is responsible for not giving exercise to the dog or the cat even. We see a lot of cats in Qatar, and I've seen how the movement of the cat has gone down when they were in wild. They were hunting, they're jumping, they're climbing. And this movement have been completely restricted, and cats have become like lazy animals. Eventually, a lot of people might be seeing cats now in their practice. The number is growing very rapidly. What has happened 20 years back in Europe is happening in India now, because cats are low maintenance animals than dogs. But therefore, the number of cats, cat lovers are increasing because they need small space, and less food is not a criteria. But yes, to some extent, eat less food, and they are we don't have to take them for walks for pee and poo, and they are also considered as clean animals. So number of cat population is also increasing. So if you see the statistics in US, the osteoarthritis numbers are increasing rapidly, and almost a quarter population, dog population in US is suffering from osteoarthritis, and ultimately it is leading to pain and limb dysfunction. So whenever the arthritis is set, first of all, the dog will not be moving much. So the limb dysfunctionality, the functionality is reduced, or there is favorism of that particular leg. The dog will try to favor his leg while walking or jumping. He'll stop jumping into car. And the client will recognize these symptoms, right? Because they'll understand that, this guy was jumping in the car. He was very happy to go out and jump into the car. Now he's very reluctant. I have to push him in the car. So your bell should ring that why the dog is not getting into the car. So you should look whether the dog is young, old, or very old. So I see arthritis in very young dogs, like 5 years dog, which I never saw it earlier. And there's too much of inbreeding happening in India, where a lot of Labradors, Rottweilers, and Golden Retrievers, Great Danes are getting into these problems. And this lifestyle disease have become like a nuisance for the pet owners now. Because day before yesterday, we did a dog with a cryptorchid dog, and the owner used to always complain that the dog is not able to get up properly. So when the dog was in anesthesia, because that owner was very fussy, so we wanted to sedate the dog and then finish most of the studies, because the owner will never allow you to sedate the dog again. So we did his hip radiographs and the spinal studies and the shoulder radiographs, and we found there are a lot of osteophytes. So these things are sometimes whenever you whenever you do like a chest X-ray or just taken for X-ray for spinal studies or bladder for bladder stones. So also look at the joint, what is happening at the joint. Look at the spondylosis is coming up. Look at the joint surfaces of the hip joint. Look at the stifle, because these are already there. Only you have to look for that. So whenever the radiograph is in front of you, you just don't look at the problem. Start not looking at the problem, but start looking for things which are normal. So when you start looking for things which are normal, and you will hit on something which you never expected. So when you tell the client that along with the stone, the bladder stones, kidney stones, or a stone in the ureter, your dog also has spondylosis. Your dog also has arthritis. So you are making, you are creating an awareness to the client. And when you create awareness, that is the time you are also increasing your share of concern for the pet, because this client, a happy client will say, my vet has diagnosed this disease 5 years back, which is now more prominent and creating problem. So the client is aware of, along with your bladder stones, your client is aware of the disease which is pertaining there. So he is already in a mindset that I need some joint supplements. I need to take care of this. I need to swim my dog. I need to motivate my dog for swimming. Or see, when only the medication is not important. So it is a combination of medication, various therapies. Because nowadays problem is not just sorted by one medication. There's no miracle cure as such for anything. Even if you do a surgery, you have to have multiple modalities of treatment and therapies. You have to combine them, because this multiple modalities will only be beneficial for your patient. So trust me, if you have done orthopedic surgery, you have to combine with your antibiotics, your painkillers, your glucosamine chondroitin sulfate. You have to give physiotherapy, you have to give laser treatment, you have to involve the client by explaining the condition, you have to ask the client to do cold fomentation for 5 days. So explaining and making aware of a problem is the key for success for what you are doing, for your treatment, for your surgeries, most of the stuff. So I would always advise you to look into precise things, explaining the client very well. So the secondary things what lead to osteoarthritis are the cranial cruciate ligament disease. So even if I address the cranial cruciate rupture by a TPLO surgery, I have to tell my client that your dog will be walking fine for 5 years, but ultimately after 5 years, this joint is going to have arthritis. So you are giving good 5 years to this dog, but when you tell this dog, the owner, that the arthritis is going to be set in, he's already prepared. So once, if you do a Labrador who's got a meniscal tear or anterior cruciate rupture, you have to also tell that this problem will be coming in the other joint also, because the cruciate ligaments are just fibers, and it has been scientifically proven that Labradors and Golden Retrievers who are being inbred a lot have this cruciate ligament ruptures are very common, because the fibers are weak in that. So if you get in one joint, you'll also get in another joint. So in Bangalore, I have operated a mastiff 2 years back, and last year again he had a broken cruciate on the other leg. So I had already told the client that so this problem is going to be right now in one joint, it will come in another joint also. So make your client prepared for the upcoming problems which are going to rise up in 2 years, 3 years, or 4 years of time. So awareness is very important. So hip dysplasia is also contributing to a lot of osteoarthritis. Elbow dysplasia is again, OCD is there. Patellar dislocations are there. Patellar dislocation, if you get a toy breed, now always right from the puppyhood, you have to look the patellas of these toy breeds. Make a habit, make a ritual for your practice that you look at the patellas. It's very simple example. You just cup the stifles and stand behind a dog and pull towards you. And if there is a problem in the patellas will be either deviating medially or laterally. So a very simple thing. Always when you do a physical examination of a of a puppy, look for the testicles. If there are in the inguinal canal, or they're not completely descended, or they're already in the abdomen. So this small examinations, look at the congruity, how the joints are congruent, like do the stifle joint feel normal, or one is swollen, another is not swollen. So look at this joint, where looking at this joint is very, very important, because looking, just cupping your hands is like, it's everything. It's a MRI, it's a CT scan, and trust, God has given you two beautiful hands, use them. And no physical examination can be replaced by any diagnostic aid. Just trust me. And also, osteoarthritis also, look at the obesity, the gender, exercise, and the diet also. Some clients, they want to grow their puppy very fast, so they give a very high protein diet to these puppies. So these dogs will ultimately grow very fast. So they grow very fast, they put on more weight, and there's a lot of stress on the joint. Early age neutering is also creating problems because it delays the fusion of the growth plate. So early age neutering has been now, a lot of orthopedic surgeons have come to the conclusion that dogs who have been neutered at very early age will have cruciate problems and they have the growth plate problems. So always tell your client that this your dog can have a stifle problem. It's a big dog if you do early age neutering. Because see, just earning that your money at that particular point is not important. You should always consider the repercussion of the future, in fact. So osteoarthritis are also because of the result of mechanical and biological factors and destabilize the normal coupling. So what are the mechanical factors? The mechanical factors are like whenever the cruciate is ruptured, whenever the dog is moving, so the stifle is not going to move properly. So it will be, there will be always bone on bone rubbing. So what I'm doing whenever there is bone on bone rubbing, it will, my joints are getting degraded. My osteophytes are coming in. My inflammation is coming in the joint. So what is happening? Ultimately, you can see that there is a lot of inflammation, osteophytes coming in, they'll sit on the joint surface, and the meniscal will tear up eventually. And if you don't address the dog's joint, is very painful. He will be lame, and there will be lot of articular surface damage in that. So what happens? There is a lot of proteolytic. So what is happening? And there is a lot of proteolytic breakdown of the cartilage happening. And in stage two, fibrillation and erosion of the cartilage surface happens, and breakdown of products released into the synovial fluid, resulting into the joint swelling, as I told you. So the third stage is the synovial inflammation begins with the synovial cells ingest a breakdown product through phagocytosis and produce protease and pro-inflammatory cytokines, which results. Basically, the protease and the pro-inflammatory cytokines result into pain. So if you read a lot of painkiller, the insects what are put in the tablets and all, so it will say that it is anti-protease and it is taking care of inflammation. So it is acting on cytokinases. So that helps into relieving the pain. So if I see the stifle is a joint where 90% of big dogs, Labradors, Golden Retrievers, Mastiffs, Bull Mastiffs, you will see the stifle is getting more affected, and the shoulder joint and the hip joint later on. So the stifle is like a a joint where very easy to study, and whenever you open a stifle joint for a patellar dislocation, even you can see there's a lot of osteophytes growing in because the patella was moving in a wrong direction. If it is medial, you can see on the processes, just adjacent to the groove, the patella groove, where the patella is moving on the distal end of femur. So you can see the lot of osteophytes. And if you see like beads of osteophytes growing in here, and these are setting up the arthritis in the joint. And if you do scintigraphy, on scintigraphy, you will see that these bones, it is considered like a hot joint, you see that the joint is inflamed. In elbow dysplasia is also responsible for a lot of osteoarthritis, and you have to definitely address The elbow joint is a very complex joint. So it is formed by too many bones. And if a dog in growing stage has any trauma to the elbow joint, and you will have ununited anconeal process, you can have OCD, you can have fragmented coronoid process. Fragmented coronoid processes are very common nowadays because of the inbreeding again. And these processes, you have to take them off because the joint is very painful. And it's again a rewarding surgery. Once you remove the ununited anconeal process, FCP, once you address it, it really helps a lot to the dog's movement as such. You can find like micro cracks in the elbow joint because of trauma or very high, I see a lot of melanomas coming in India, and these are very high stung dogs. And these high stung dogs in growing stage will have a lot of micro crack formations because they jump a lot. Owner want to swing in frisbees for them. And I've seen people tying a tire on them and they jump through the tire and then they land on their forelegs, resulting into a lot of damage in the elbow joint. So, as I told you, on basis of the activity also, you can diagnose a lot of things. Like you can just imagine like how the dog is jumping. And if you have a dog who has fallen from some height or a cat fallen from some height, always try to reconstruct the whole process, like what might have happened, how the cat might have jumped, how the fracture might have formed. If the dog has a car accident, try to imagine like, depending on the radiograph, you see the impact, where the impact injury is there. When you get into the, when you open the fracture area, see the trauma which is there, you'll see where the impact is there, there'll be like a big hematoma there. So, as I told you that your observation you have to always keep your eyes open and try to observe things very minutely, because this is going to help you to design putting your plate. You'll know where your how the plate is going to support and how the forces will be taken care of, how rigid you have to put the implant inside, because things are very important in selecting the implant. Because in young puppies are growing very fast, the bones are frail, you should not use a very rigid implants for them. You should use things which you can take them off easily, or not going to create too much of stress on the bone, because those bones are very frail. So selection of the implant also depends on the strength of bone. So osteoarthritic disease is a result of both, as I told you, genetic, I think the slide is again repeated, sorry for that. But facts of OA, osteoarthritis in simple terms, is that you can manage osteoarthritis, but you can't cure it. You can do arthroscopy and remove the damaged area of the joint, remove the osteophytes which are hampering the joint movement. But ultimately, this you can give the pain relief to the dog for a few months, a few years. But ultimately, again, it will come back. So during the process, you can tell the client that I'm doing this because now the dog is young. It will help into improvement of the quality of life. Around 20% dogs are affected by osteoarthritis, and the life expectancy of the dog is reduced to 20% as compared to unaffected animals. And the multimodal management is required. As I told you, that multimodal management is very, very important. Obesity is the factor which is definitely to be taken care of. And whenever I see a lot of obese people and obese dog. So whenever I tell them that I tell them to take the dog for a walk and exercise him. So ultimately, I tell them this will help your obesity also. So sometimes you have to make the client aware that most of the dogs look alike. The dog and the owner look mostly the same. So you have to also consider that these obese dogs have the longevity of the life is reduced because of the obesity. Because obese dogs, it's like a big building standing on a very weak foundation. So the foundation are the four legs, and the big building is the body. So the legs have to take all the weight of the body. So there will be erosion of joints. There will be micro cracking happening in the joints. There will be the overstretching of the ligaments. There will be more wear and tear of the cartilage. The meniscal tear will be there. So all these factors have to be considered and explained to the clients, that the kidney size increases, the anesthesia required for the dog because of the fat, the risk increases, the heart size increases. The overall, it produces a lot of stress in all the organs. So you have to be very, very particular in advising people that obesity is not good for dogs and even for human beings, because these obese dogs will also get hypothyroidism. So if you see an obese dog, always do the thyroid test and try to evaluate the thyroid and put this dog, because if you don't treat the thyroid, the obesity will not go. And most of the neutered dogs, female dogs, will have obesity issues because of the thyroid, and ultimately leading into orthopedic problem. So it's a like a mixed blend, I feel, the obesity, hypothyroidism, joint degenerative joint disease because of obesity ultimately happening like that. So you treat one of issue, you treat hypothyroidism, treat obesity by putting on reducing diet, put on mobility support for them, and put on exercise, weight reduction program, because ultimately that is going to help. Hip dysplasia is, everybody knows that the end result of hip dysplasia is the degenerative joint diseases, where there is, again, when the puppy is there, try to do the X-ray. If you find the dog is limping, there's no harm in doing an early age radiograph. And try to do, if you're doing a dog, evaluating a dog at 4 months or 5 months or 6 months of age for hip dysplasia, try to see that dog and take good pictures. A lot of vets are scared of doing sedation in dogs, because I don't know, if you're doing the surgeries, do the sedation, because pre-med meds give you better views of X-ray, and the dog is not moving. You are doing an effortless examination, because these dogs are very painful. The dysplastic dogs, whenever you try to move the hip joint and examine them, the otolani signs, looking for otolani signs, they're very painful. So, and the muscles are not relaxed. Well, there's a lot of stretching of muscles. The dog is trying to be very stiff. So these things are to be, the sedation is very important for this dog, because otherwise it is not going to help. And you should look at the joint laxity, in fact. A lot of St. Bernard dogs, I feel, they have these ligament problems, where the ligaments are, the collateral ligaments are not formed properly, or they are like sometimes not grown properly, or there is a joint deformities in their stifle joints and other joints. So you have to look into the laxity of these joints, because this laxity is ultimately going to produce osteoarthritis. So you see that in hip dysplasia, there's a lot of severe cartilage wear off, and the femoral head is getting rubbed because of the bone-to-bone rubbing. There's a lot of different modulation happening in the hip joint. The neck is completely destroyed. Then on the neck, you see the osteophytes have grown in. And what happens, this pushes the, once the osteophyte grows in, they push the joint away from the ball and socket joint. There's a lot of muscle irritation happening, and the nerve rubbing is happening, and the nerve pinching is happening. So these dogs will be mainly quite lame because of this. So if you catch up a dog in early age, or in, you know, old age, and you're not able to do, mainly in German Shepherds, this surgery, the pectineus myotomy surgery, is very, very simple surgery, and you don't need a training. Once you look into, once this surgery, you can do it yourself. So because the pectineus muscles are the muscles which are going to pull the hip joint inward. If you stand yourself and stretch your legs and palpate your pectineus muscles, they're very easy to palpate, because they're very, very stiff and rigid muscles. When you stretch the leg of a dog under anesthesia, and you try the to feel the thigh inside where the your femoral artery is running, the pulsating artery is running. Just caudal to that is the pectineus muscle, which is very stiff and it's a very single muscle and stands out very clearly. So when you stretch out the joint and take an incision directly over the pectineus muscle, separate the skin, get into the pectineal muscle, cut it, and once you separate it, the jaw, the dog will have the extended legs post-surgery, and the dog will walk with flying legs a little bit initially. But it gives a lot of joint relief because there is a nerve which is supplying the femoral head. And once you cut the pectineus muscle, there's a lot of relaxation of the nerve, and it really helps. Then OCD, we have already discussed, like you can go into the joint and do the deep debridement of the joint and helps into the joint movement because the articular cartilages are prone to get damaged because of the OCD. So then the current therapy in osteoarthritis is like many therapies have come up. You can use non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs like meloxicam, carprofen, sulfonated glycoaminoglycane like Adequan. So when we didn't have when we did not have the other polysulfonated aminoglycane, I used to import Adequan from US and use a lot in the practice, and it really gave very good results in the practice because it helps into the joint mobility very well. And then supplementation of hyaluronic acid and chondroitin sulfate and glucosamine has been always on mind, and it really helps well in the therapy itself. The CBD oil is also very helpful in dogs with painful joints because it's a oil made from cannabis. It is again a morphine derivative and really helps well. The dog gets a little groggy with that, but the pain management is very well. So physiotherapy and hydrotherapy is also to be used in your practice very often. Try to get the physiotherapist in your practice because ultimately the physiotherapy is going to help a lot in relaxing the muscles. And in hydrotherapy, the good thing in hydrotherapy is like when your dog is swimming in the water, the wet, there's not much of wet which is bone on the bones. So the muscles get very well exercised because when you run the dog on the road, there is also the thrust which is created on the bones and the degeneration of bones can happen. But in hydrotherapy, most of the human patients also are asked to walk in the water because the weight is not borne by the bones as such. So the dog can swim freely on the water surface and use his muscles for the movement. Acupuncture is also very popular. Acupuncture really helps well where your nerve pinching is there, and it really helps aids into management of the pain because whenever you are doing acupuncture, there is a pain release happens, and there are some important factors, they get stimulated, and because of that there is a lot of pain relief. I've been using a lot of laser therapy and in my post-operative patients because they help, the laser therapy helps. It's getting more popular day by day, and once you use the laser therapy, initially I thought it's a placebo effect as such, but when I started using the companion animal laser therapy, which is fantastic, and I'm very happy that with that. So now the new visco supplements are coming with hyaluronic acids, which elevate, which remove the pain through injection of a gel-like substance and mimic the natural lubricant. So what happens when there's a wear and tear of joint, the joint fluid or the lubrication of the joint is reduced and the cushioning of the joint is reduced. So to have the cushioning effect again in the joint, the viscose supplements with the hyaluronic acid, this has been widely used in human patients now. So what they do if the patient is going for a joint replacement, so before going in joint replacement, if they don't have enough appointments for doing the joint replacement therapy, they'll start, ask them to inject the viscose supplementation with hyaluronic acid, because it forms like a cushion for temporary cushion in the joint, and the patient really feels better, which have been now widely used abroad, still yet to come in India, but I am very sure that with growing pharmaceutical evolvement, more of the companies are coming at time of, with foreign companies and getting up into new stuff. I use a lot of platelet-rich plasma in my practice. And I tell you, trust me, it is a fabulous thing which works amazingly in dogs, and very, very easy and very effective procedure, a very rewarding procedure, I'll say. Only thing you have to have, if you want to look into that, there are a lot of YouTube videos how to do the platelet, how to extract the platelet-rich plasma and inject it. And as I told you that you can do it ultrasound guided intra-articularly, you can inject, and it really works fabulous. I've people who have not gone for surgery for not people I mean patients who have not gone for surgery for partial cruciate tear, I've used them, and you have to use once in 15 days initially, and then once a month, and these dogs have done really well even without the surgery. So ultimately, I don't know what will happen to these dogs. Ultimately, they'll at one point of time they'll need a surgery for that if the cruciate ligament ruptures completely. But PRP is the in thing you should always try in that. So I use PRP for my wound healing. I use PRP for my joints, arthritic joints of different types. It really helps a lot. I use PRP for corneal ulcers also. It really works well. So once you start using in practice, and don't shut off yourself by using multimodal therapy, because you might have failed. You might have failed using that one particular therapy because probably you didn't follow the asepsis, or you did not. You relied on somebody to clean the joint or disinfect the joint properly. But don't get disheartened by just one failure. Failures should always help you to rise. I remember a song saying that, higher you make my barriers, faster I'll run. So the way, if your barriers are created, faster you run to create your barriers, come over your barriers. So in your practice also, there will be a lot of barriers coming up, but you have to work on your barriers and try to work on yourself and understand why these barriers are coming up in your practices. Because practice is just management of things. It is a combination of knowledge. It is a combination of devotion. It is a combination of client communication, client follow-up, patient and you should have empathy in treating your patients, because if you don't have that chest to love animals or just don't do for money, money will automatically come in. If you do a combination, a recipe of all these things, you'll be a successful practitioner. So to cut in short, the PRP has around 250 growth factors, which act as an anti-inflammatory. So it helps the fibroblasts for new generation formation, new blood formations happen. Therefore it is called as, and the platelets are always there. So it's called as platelet-rich plasma. So don't try to take platelet. If you have to do the normal platelet count for these dogs, if you're doing platelet, if the dog had a tick fever, don't use that the blood for extracting the platelets, because the platelet count was already low. So I would like to always tell you that don't use the platelets. If the platelet count is low, don't use it. So you just need a centrifugal machine. You can draw the blood either from the either from any of the nerves, which are either from a jugular vein or any other vein, which is going to give you around 10 to 14 ml of blood to do the. You don't need a very high tech centrifugal machine. You can buy on Amazon the very cheap centrifugal machines, and only if you need PRP tubes, which you can buy from a supplier who is already supplying you the blood collection vials for you. There are a lot of bone growth promoting factors like hydroxyapatite, which really works pretty well in growth promotion and is suitable for using in routine surgical procedures for small animals. So if you have a bone loss, if you find that you have to remove one piece of bone while doing the surgery, the fragment which is not supported by any muscle or which is hanging out and just comes out with the edema, you can always replace with this bone growth promoters. There are like biocompatibility and hydroxy peptide is attributed for hexagonal crystal structures and which have similar mineral phase to the bone tissue, and they have the porosity also, and their bioceramics also coming up very well. And autogenous bone grafts are a gold standard, but then autogenous bone grafts are generally done at a institutional level. But nowadays in Europe you can buy bone grafts and you can place them during the surgery, which are sterile grafts, and in surgery you can open them up and then use them. And bioceramics are growing very, very popular now because they are available in large amounts and have a same chemical composition similar to the vertebrate mineral phases. In addition to their biocompatible bioactivity and the osteoconductivity is very good. So these are like this look like this is a bioceramic like a granule which looks like a bone, and there is a bone loss you can put into that. You get pillars of bioceramic also which you can cut and put in inside the bone wherever the bone loss is there, and you can put a rigid fixation, and in between the rigid fixation you can put the bioceramics. Bioceramics help into growing of bones. In fact, these have been used in lot where there is a lot of bone crushing and bone loss. So whenever there is a lot of bone loss, there you can use the bioceramics. It is available in human now, but whenever these things are, whenever you're using some artificial material, the asepsis has to be very, the OT has to be very aseptic, and none of the orthopedic procedures can be done in a sterile condition. So sterility has to be maintained in all surgical patients. Then food modification is come up a long way for managing osteoarthritis. GLM is a green lipid muscle, which are like the shellfish, which is generally in New Zealand. It comes from New Zealand, but India also I've heard some people are artificially growing them and supplying to the pharmacy. It really helps well. All dogs which were fed, there's an American study which were fed with a balanced diet over 30 days control period with GLM enriched diet over a 60 days time. Period showed beneficial effect of GLM enriched diet. So green lipid muscle, even in human being there in osteoarthritis, they advise to eat because it helps the GLM itself helps, which is in elevation of the pain and remove, because it supplements the omega-3 fatty acids and You can. I advise a lot of people to have fish oil in their dog's meal because eventually it helps a lot. And I prefer to use salmon oil. If salmon oil is not available, you can ask them to use any fish which is in high in oil content, which really helps a lot. This is a new product which has been very exclusively used in Europe and US. Cyanovitin is again a homogeneous colloid. It's a radionucleotide. For injecting this this product, you have to take special training, and you need to take specialized precaution because it's a radioactive product which has to be injected in the joint. You can inject in elbow joint, stifle joint, shoulder joint, and it helps in the phagocytosis of the macrophages without adverse affecting the adjacent synoviocytes. So because what happens, the synovial fluid gets disturbed and there's a lot of sinusitis, that is inflammation of the sinuses of the joint happens, and there's a lot of synovial fluid coming in and inflammatory process happening in. So this product is working pretty well. They've tried in human this. The only thing, you have to be trained for this, not available in India yet, but I'm a person which believes into modern science, and modern science always helps a lot to take it to the future. Because if you start using new stuff in your practice, eventually you'll be always ready to use another new product which is coming in the market. You can always stick on to the old things also, if you're comfortable with that, but always try to use new products. Evolving your practice is key to success, I would say. Coming to almost my last slide, I'm very thankful to Vetina for introducing Pentosan. Pentosan, I've been using in my practice, which was available when it was the equines. And when I was using Adequan, and when Adequan was very difficult to get from abroad, and I saw Pentosan being widely used. Actually, one of my friend was using it in horses, and then I started using in my practice because Adequan was not available. And I was very happy because I've been using this product over now 4 years of time. And it really helps one. It's got chondroprotective activities and plays a vital role in maintaining the cartilage integrity. It helps to improve the capillary blood flow and maintaining the nutritional supply to intervertebral discs also. So in IVD also, you can use this. I use in a lot of patients with spondylosis in dogs. So you can use very well in spondylosis. Actually, this product is being used widely in human patients for cystitis. But I was reading for a lot of papers, and they didn't find, they have literally injected intravesical into the bladder to see if it regenerates the surface of the bladder in dogs, but they didn't have much success in that. Eventually, I think with some other mixture of products, they may come up with something like that. But right now, I've read a lot of papers; it's not being so useful. So you can use in intervertebral disc disease. You can use in arthritis. And it works very well. So the day when you inject, don't use any non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs or use any steroid during that period. At least for 4 days, don't use anything. Then you can switch on to your carprofen or meloxicam, whatever you're using. There's no report for using cats yet. I've not seen anybody using in cats. But the efficacy is very good. The dose rate is 3 mg per kg body weight. If you use in post-operative dogs also, when you are weaned off from your original painkillers, like the non-steroidal painkillers, I've used in a dog with a bone fracture and even in a particular dislocation after repairing the placing back the patella this dog had a lot of, I have a video, I'll show it, as a small dog, and I got a very successful rate. So only be careful that we be precise in 3 mg per kg body weight, because the vial is small and I think it has got 100 mg in that. So calculate the dose. Don't, if in your busy practice, don't go by the volume of drug, small dog, small dose, but be precise. Every time, invest in a weighing scale. I'll advise Vetina to start gifting weighing scale to veterinarians rather than giving things which are not being used in the practice. So it will be like a, whenever they'll weigh every dog, single dog, they'll remember you. So at least do that. It will be very helpful. So pentosan is again a counterproductive drug, as I told you. Helps very well in osteoarthritis. It helps into improving of degradation of the cartilage and positive effects on the chondrocyte metabolism, which encourages the repair of articular cartilage. So I think they're going to run a presentation for that. I'm really happy using this product and use it. Once you use it, as I told you, you will evolve your practice, and definitely it's a multi modal therapy. 3 mg per kg weight, so 1 ml per kg, 33 kgs of body weight. You have to use subcutaneously for 7 days. I have a patient in Qatar, that dog was on Adequan, and then later on Adequan is not available in Qatar, so we use pentosan. It really produces a similar effect. This dog is like, I have a case study of this, and this dog is doing pretty well. So word of caution for pentosan: do not use in combination with steroids and non-steroidal anti-inflammatory. Do not give when there is low platelet count. And if the dog is on any blood thinners like aspirin or any anti-clotting agents, watch for adverse drug reactions, very important. So Maya is a big Pyrenees dog. She is around 65 kilos in Qatar. Came from the US, was always on Adequan. And then this dog was referred to me by a European vet for osteoarthritis management. He thought that this dog may need surgery eventually. When I did radiographs, and there's a lot of arthritis in all our joints, and the owner is very hell-bent on not letting the dog lose the way. So she's got a very heavy dog and finds it very difficult to get up from where she's sitting because of obesity. She hardly walks walks well, just goes out and pees and comes back and stays there. So because of her obesity, the joint problem has become, there's a lot of muscle stiffness coming in. So we use pentosan now once a month. Every month we've been using for a long time, and we run once a month the kidney function test for this dog. And she is also on glucosamine chondroitin sulfate and continuously. And when the bad days are there, we put on Remedil when there's too much of joint pain as such. So this is a miniature pom, 5 years mocha with a long standing patella. Resulted in the arthritis of the affected joint. He did the deepening of patellar groove there and tibial tuberosity transposition in this dog. And after finishing the course of antibiotic and the painkillers, like as I always told you, that pentosan can be used in conjunction with non-steroidal anti-inflammatory. So then we, after 21 days of surgery, we used pentosan and the mobility markedly improved. So I'm sharing this small video to you. Jumpy dog. She's just 2.5 month old dog, and initially this was post-operative. She's limping because she has got 2 K wires in to fix the tibial tuberosity transposition, what we did. And with the laser therapy, she had very marked improvement in a joint later on. So I just fast forward this. Oops. You see that? She is back on her legs. a happy dog. We still have to remove the implants, and once we remove the implants, there'll be a normal, the mobility is almost normal now. So you can add to the recipe Stride, which is again coming from Vatina, glucosamine content in sulfate, like supplementation, well, and to add to the recipe of your pain management and the therapy. So thank you very much for being there and helping animals. And I am always proud, and I'm proud of you all veterinarians listening to me so carefully. And I'll be ready for your question and answers. Are we good, Vikas?
Thank you, Dr. Atikar. It was a wonderful presentation. Thank you so much. We'll be having the question and answer session after a quick recap from Dr. Charu. Dr. Charu, are you there?
Yes, hi.
Yeah. Dr. Charu Churamani, she is the product technical head at Swati Spentos. She has done masters in veterinary public health and from All India Institute of Hygiene and Public Health, Kolkata. She is a second generation vet and has been intern at a lot of veterinary establishments, at military establishments and labs. Specially targeted to equines. So we welcome Dr. Charu.
Thank you so much, Dr. Seema, for giving me this opportunity to share the panel with somebody as experienced and knowledgeable as Dr. Hartikar. So I'll not take much time, and I'll straight away dive into what Pentos is and what we here at Swati Spentos are doing. So I'll just share my slide.
Please go ahead.
Yeah. Is it okay?
Yes.
Okay. So, I'm Dr. Charu Churamani, and I work here at Swati Spentos. And Swati Spentos is a human and veterinary pharmaceutical company. And we take great pride in, the manufacturing, the kind of products that we've been manufacturing are very targeted and specific niche category products. So we've been in the service of healthcare for almost 50 years now. And when it comes to the veterinary sector, I think Pentos is one of our gem products. And it's not some newly touted product that is being introduced. It's just new to the Indian subcontinent. And Pentos is actually, by Swati Spentos, is India's first such product. So apart from that, apart from being the manufacturers in the Indian subcontinent, we're also supplying and exporting the product to UAE, Singapore, all the West Asia and the Central Asian countries. Apart from that, we have the same active ingredient, which is available for canines as well as equines. And I don't know how many of you are pursuing or were interested in keeping a tab on Olympics this year. So the equines, our Indian player has actually made it to the Olympics. So many doctors, veterinarians who are sending their equines to Olympics or any such international eventing and other games use Pentos 250, which is Swati Spentos' product for the equine osteoarthritis, as a prophylactic choice of drug as well, just to maintain a good, cartilage health. So even in abroad, even in European countries, the ingredient PPS is used a lot for sport animals and just before the game seasons. So what osteoarthritis is? So I'm not going to touch this. The real guru has actually given us absolutely beautiful presentation and details about what osteoarthritis is. The whole basic hallmark of osteoarthritis is degeneration of the cartilage. So what are the major causes of it are basically the lifestyle, the genetic disorders, certain breeds are more prone to it. So because of these multiple factors, your animal becomes prone to osteoarthritis. Now, what all the options are available and why I would suggest that pentosan polysulfate sodium is a much more superior option is A, all the options like NSA IDs that veterinarians generally prefer and depend on do not target the underlying cause of the disease. They're all temporary solutions to the clinical signs and symptoms that you encounter. And apart from that, I think we're all aware how NSA IDs have the tendency to mark some form of liver toxicity and cause GIT disturbances, which can ultimately deteriorate the health. And there have been so many, you know, randomized clinical trials that have given us proof that when it comes to using NSA IDs for osteoarthritis, there is no beneficial effects when it comes to the hematological abnormalities that take place in an osteoarthritic joint, or rather it basically just pushes forward and deteriorates the joint by promoting osteonecrosis and intravascular degeneration. So apart from that, Adequan, as Dr. Hartiker had already emphasized on how great Adequan is, PPS by Pentose 100 is exactly the same product. The only difference is that our product is absolutely organic. It's plant-based. So the animal sources tend to have some reactions with the other animals upon interaction. And apart from that, you know, how you mentioned he used to import it from US. So that's a costly affair. Apart from that, all the other treatments that we have, like physiotherapy, hydrotherapy, need great precision. You need to have master of the, you know, of these therapies. You need to be an expert, and they can be costly for a lot of people to basically afford this. So these all therapies can be your supportive. They can be an add-on to your treatment. But Pentose 100, which is for canines, is actually the most direct modifying osteoarthritic drug that is available in the globe right now for osteoarthritis. And there's clinical proof to it. And apart from that, it's been in practice from I think 1980s, and it's being used even in humans for treating osteoarthritis. So yes, I feel it is definitely a better and a much more superior choice. Now, when it comes to the mechanism of action, how it is combating the issue is, you know, the key components of a joint are your proteoglycans, then your hyaluronic acid, and the circulation. So it has an effect on all these elements. As you know, it inhibits interleukin 1, TNF alpha pathways, which are directly responsible for inducing enzymes like MMP13, which ultimately cause degeneration of your cartilage. So when PPS is in action, it will inhibit TNF alpha, and ultimately it is directly inhibiting further deterioration of the cartilage. So that's how it is preventing degeneration. And it also being, you know, it has heparin-like properties. It is, in strength, it is around 1/10 of heparin. So because of that, it has these properties where it can be helping in increasing the blood flow and breakdown of the clots. And ultimately, it increases the hyaluronic acid concentration that makes the joint far more lubricant, and giving you a far better overall chondroprotective structure and shifting the catabolic state of the joint to a healthier normal condition. So the product profile is it's a 10 ml vial which has concentration of 100 mg per ml. The content is pentosan polysulfate sodium, which comes as a pale yellow color solution. The dosage, as mentioned earlier, is 3 mg per kg body weight. So it comprises of 4 injections in one course. And we recommend that veterinarians strictly adhere to the dosing of 3 mg per kg body weight and give the complete course of it to see the proper results. Generally, we witness a lot of veterinarians just give one injection and terminate the course. So the right protocol of you know, following the dosage is to do the entire course, complete the entire course. It can be given intramuscularly, it can be given intra-articular wise, or subcutaneously either. So that is, I think, a veterinarian's call. And depending upon whether the case is mild to severe, the number of courses can be increased up to, you know, 4 courses. I mean, you can give it one course if the case is mild, one course that includes 4 injections, or you can go with 2 courses on half-yearly basis of interval, or three courses on quarterly basis of interval. So that is something that depends upon the kind of case that you have, the damage that is present in osteo of the joint. So yeah, these are the basic clinical cases in which you can depend on pentos 100, and for equines we have pentos 250. And yeah, I think that's it from my side. And yeah, thank you so much, Dr. Seema.
Thank you, Dr. Charu. Thank you so much for the wonderful presentation and the information shared about pentos. Now we'll go ahead with the question and answer session.
I think they've just two questions yes. were asked, I think so.
Yes, yes. There are many questions. Shall we go ahead with the questions?
Yeah, sure. Can you read out? I can just answer them.
Yes, sir. So the first question is from Dr. Lalit, wherein he has asked how to prevent the rupture of cranial cruciate ligament or the anterior cruciate ligament, and how we deal with that condition if any dog got it accidentally, and what the surgery steps.
Basically, you can't. He's saying how to prevent the rupture of ACL. ACL tear, as I told you, will happen in dogs with weak ACL. Either it's a sports injury, or if you throw a ball and the dog runs after it and suddenly stops or turn, the ball rebounds from the wall, the dog will suddenly turn. And when the dog turns there will be a lot of pressure from on the right leg if it's turning on right side, or if it's turning on the left side. So the sudden pressure, the whole body weight comes on that cruciate ligament when the dog is turning as they run. So this dog with weak cruciate will rupture it. So if you have a dog like a Labrador, which you know has been inbred, try to avoid the throwing of ball and fetching the ball, because that will definitely aid into crucial injury. And the surgery is called as a TPLO. It needs a special training. If it's a small dog, you can do the extracapsular repair, which is much easier. But in big dogs, extracapsular repair doesn't work out. So you have to do TPLO or TTA. So these are the two surgeries. You have to, Lalit, you have to definitely do some course to do a surgery, or if you have, you want to do some courses, we have training courses coming up if the COVID helps us to do that. But basically, you have to do the basic training initially in orthopedics, and then you can go. This is a very advanced surgery, so you'll need definitely some lot of training for that.
The same Dr. Lalit has asked another question related to cranial cruciate ligament, that what is the findings in X-ray for the rupture of cranial
cruciate ligament? The X-ray will show there is an increase in the joint fluid, the quantity of joint fluid, swelling of joint, the fat pad will be distorted, and the angle, the tibio plateau angle will be changed. You will find that there is a sharpness in the angle, which will be going up to 30, 35 degrees. So you have to look at the angle also, and there will be a draw sign. Whenever you are palpating the joint, you have to see whether there is a draw. When the cruciate ligament ruptures, there are a lot of good videos to examine the stifled joint, which shows how to look at the draw. And then you can also look do the tibial thrust. You have to put a lot of pressure on the tibia, and the tibia glides over the distal end of femur if there is a cruciate rupture. So you also see the draw there. So you can look on videos, and if you want, I can share you some videos. You can share your email ID, give it to Seema, and then Seema can pass it on.
Yes, sir, definitely. Next question is from Dr. Ashok. He's saying, how to differentiate orthopedic and nerve pain?
Differentiating orthopedic pain and nerve pain is you do an orthopedic examination, and when you are doing the orthopedic examination and you press a bone or press a joint, and the pain is elevated in the doing that, not elevated, it becomes more prominent, the dog will wince or whine. So at that time, is considered to be orthopedic pain. And the neurological pain are like whenever the dog has got intervertebral disc disease, and these dogs cry for a longer time and they evince in pain, like they'll howl a lot, and suddenly when the nerve pinches, the dog will suddenly do it quick, or something like that. So the neurological pain is elevated like that. And whenever you make the dog walk, as I told you, in orthopedic examination, you can see the pain of how it is. And when you press the joint, and there is a lot of inflammation in these joints, which will, when you palpate the joints, it will start showing the pain. And in neurological pain, you have to do a proper neurological examination. You can look into for neurological, like doing a neurological exam in dogs in YouTube. They have wonderful videos which have been put by many places.
The next question is from Dr. Prashanta.
Prashanta, we do a lot of orthopedic workshops. Where you have to start with a basic course and then go to an advanced course. We are working with AO speakers, and AO also runs a lot of basic course online also. So you can register with basic course right now. We believe in a lot of hands-on training courses. So if you want to do online course, you can always do into go on the AO website and register for the online courses, which are not hands-on, but you can listen to a lot of lectures or that. And once you become an AO member, you can see a lot of videos free and get into doing procedures online. You can learn some procedures.
So there's a question from anonymous person. Aren't hip and elbow dysplasia congenital? What can be done for the condition to avoid osteoarthritis?
Good breeding. You have to catch hold of good breeders. And if you're practicing together with breeders, and so always try to have a good genotype and a phenotype. Always avoid inline breeding, because line breeding is very bad. And if you know a dog is a cryptorchid kid, and he might be very good looking dog, the movement might be good, the body configuration might be very good. But if he's cryptorchid kid, don't breed him. Because a lot of breeders I see, they say that, no, single testicle hai, toh kya hua hai, koi farak nahi karta. But you are breeding a dog who's got a recessive characters. So these all these recessive characters.
Hello. Hello. Hello.
The tense muscle stimulation for dogs, but this the using of electric stimulation is coming up, is going down over physical therapy, or physiotherapy and laser therapy. Because nowadays they believe that only just the electrical stimulation is not going to help to regenerate the nerves. For regeneration of nerves, you have to give a lot of physiotherapy exercises. So the new nerve generation is much better rather than just by electrical stimulation. So along with your tense therapy, you have to have the physiotherapy also. The physical therapy. Physiotherapy is just physical therapy of massage, nerve stimulation by acupuncture or acupressure. So that's going to help into getting your nerves back to functionality.
What sedation you suggest for doctor for puppies? This is a question from Dr. Santosh.
Santosh, I can tell you, I can send you a list of recipes. Santosh is my friend. So we use a lot of dexmedetomidine along with butorphanol. If you don't have dexmedetomidine, you can do a low dose xylazine along with butorphanol. We go up to 0.1 to 0.5 mg per kg body weight, and the full dose of butorphanol along with, and it just sedates the puppies pretty well and safely. But you have to be very cautious in using pugs, this combination. Or you just need a quick sedation, you can use IV. Ketamine along with diazepam. I can send you an email which has got safer combination of sedations in dogs.
Dr. Ankit has a question, like, how much is nerve muscle electric stimulator affecting in limping problems in small animals?
Very less. In fact, we generally use for more if the nerve is. We call it like a nerve compression is there and there's a disuse of the muscles. The muscle, they start collapsing and there's no stimulation in the muscle. So limping dogs, I'll never use electric muscle stimulation for limping dogs. But the limping has to be defined. The limping is because of what? If there is a muscle, the electric stimulation is used only when the muscle atrophy is happening and not much muscle functionality is there and the muscle is getting flabby. So you have to stimulate the muscle to stimulate the blood vessel. So whenever the muscle becomes flabby, it has a lot of the innervation is getting destroyed or the nerves are not functioning well. So just the muscle stimulation is not going to, electrical stimulation is not going to happen. Or is not going to help much.
Dr. Raulkar, Ratnakar Raukar has asked, how differential diagnosis is done for hip dysplasia?
So you can just do the X-ray and look at the autonomic signs and breed specific German Shepherds will have more hip dysplasia than you have to do the physical examination and consider that these breeds are more common into having this hip dysplasia. So when you want to do a differential diagnosis of hip dysplasia, it's a very early age disease which can be easily diagnosed, and look for autonomic signs, look for how the ball and socket joint is there, how the shallowing of the fossa of the pelvic joint is there. So these are the things. If there's a shallowing of the fossa, then the right chances that the hip joint may just come out or just get deviated very easily. So do the physical examinations under sedation. If a dog is dysplastic, you'll very easily know. And then you do the radiographs under sedation, where you have to put the hips under pressure and try to bring out the hip joint outside of the socket, and then do a because there are two, is a pen method of diagnosing the hip dysplasia. I have some papers I can share with Raulkar. Raulkar is again from my college.
Yes. Anonymous person, what are the most common bone disorders you have observed in India, Indian dogs? And what was your therapeutic approach?
Bone disorders, there's nothing called as something which is limited to Indy dogs. But Indy dogs are like small dogs which are highly outbred. So for them, I feel I've seen a lot of particular dislocation in Indy dogs rather than hip dysplasia. Hip dysplasia is not very common. Traumatic hip dysplasia is common in Indy dogs, but not genetic hip dysplasia. So traumatic hip dysplasia is because of the road accident, the hip got displaced, but not the genetic predisposition of these dogs are too much of outbreeding happening in these dogs. So these dogs, I have not seen very common hip dysplasia, but I see a lot of patellar dislocation in these dogs. I don't know what is the reason.
Dr. Shrikant has asked how to treat vertebral column injuries.
Vertebral column injuries depends on what? It's a trauma. Depending if it is just trauma, then you can just and there is no deviation of the bone or spinal cord damage or spinal fracture, then you can go conservatively. You can use gabapentin. I use a lot of gabapentin in my practice because it works at the nerve level rather than other non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs work at a different level managing the bony pain. But gabapentin works pretty well at a deep neurological pain. So I like to use that.
So Dr. Ashok has said, please share a link for online courses. So definitely we'll be doing that.
Yeah, you can, once we are putting up something, you can look on my Facebook page. We put our courses on Facebook, and right now we don't have anything, but we are planning shortly to run a course in Malaysia and in India if the COVID allows us to move around the world. So we'll do a feline orthopedic course, which would be very interesting. And we are already working on making the artificial bones for them, for the people who are going to attend it, because it's a hands-on training and very intense 3 days workshop will be there. So we'll definitely announce it on Facebook.
There's a very interesting question we had from Dr. Anil. We had been advising neutering at early age. Would this increase chances of osteoarthritis or other similar disorders?
Definitely, yes. Because neutering will also promote a lot of obesity in dogs. And I am not against neutering, but neutering, early age neutering, I am against, because it definitely delays the growth rate maturity, and ultimately it weakens up the stifle, the cruciate ligament also. A lot of work has been done on hip dysplasia also, how the relation is hip dysplasia and early age neutering is working out. So I think we can always wait and tell the client let the joint the growth plate fuse, and then you can do the neutering, because it's not a SOS surgery as such. Only you can ask them to work on the behavior, because most of the Indians don't work on the behavior of the kids and the dogs, unfortunately. So I think we should always train them to work on the behavior of the dog, because neutering is generally advocated to treat the behavior, but not for other things. And for prosthetic cancers and all, you can always do it for just avoid prosthetic cancer after 14 months to 18 months of age to avoid prosthetic cancers. And that's it, I think. So should be fine.
Another anonymous question: what all are drugs you are commonly using for sedation for taking X-ray?
I use metoclopramide and butorphanol, and you can, if metoclopramide is available in India, but you have to work out on the dose rate very carefully, because metoclopramide is quite strong and the dose is very small, so you have to go according to the body weight.
Dr. Rutuja has a question: how one can collect and store BMSC, and can you elaborate the storage need for the same, whether the immediate use can be done?
What is that? I didn't get the question. BMC is what?
BMSC. Dr. Rutuja, can you elaborate that?
Because the abbreviations are different according to the different countries.
Yes, very different. yes.
Rutuja is
there? Please allow her to speak.
Yeah.
Kiran, can you allow her to speak?
She's there, or Rutuja?
What surgical procedure?
Yes, ma'am, I can allow her to speak.
Yes, please.
Yeah.
Unmute, Rutuja.
Just a minute.
Till then, we can take what surgical procedure is done for hip dysplasia. Dr. Anil Vadekar has this question.
See, in early age, I prefer to do the pectineus myotomy if the dog is before 5 years of five months of age with JPS. Jewel and pubic symphysis, because these surgeries were earlier done long time back all over Europe and England and US, where when the hip replacement was not available. Now it also has limitations, because it definitely helps a lot, because up till now, whatever dogs I've done in so many years, they're doing pretty well. But I'm very sure that these dogs will end up with osteoarthritis, because these I've just got the patients with an 8-year history in them, and they're doing pretty well up till now. There's no problem. We did not have to go for hip replacement. But if that completely dysplastic, the joint's completely out, you can't do this. You can also do toggle pinning. But ultimately, all these surgeries will end up into osteoarthritis. So they'll have to go into hip replacement, which is nobody's doing in India. So I'll do very early age. From 4 to 5 months or 6 months maximum, I'll do JPS along with pectineus myotomy. In old age dog, if the dog were already dysplastic and was osteoarthritis, I will do only pectineus myotomy. And if the dog is small, I will do FHO, femoral head osteotomy, if the dog is dysplastic, or toggle pinning, depending on the condition. Or you can also do triple, it's called as double pelvic osteotomy now, which there's a special plate for that. But again, the window for that is again up to 6 months to maximum 7 months. But 5 months of age, if you do this surgery, is very, very rewarding. So you can do it at that time.
The full form is like a bone marrow stem cells.
Bone marrow stem cells she's asking for.
Yes.
I've been using a lot of stem cells in the practice along with the students. We were tied up with University of Pune, where they have a state-of-art stem cell extraction and regrowing along with the components which help into bone development and cartilage development. But we found that one girl had done a thesis on this, two girls rather, and both are studied. One is in Canada working very well. She did a PhD and other one is in the US. But stem cells have very limitations. We found that when the stem cells were injected, we had only a window of only not more than even three months to 4 months. The dog used to walk for very well for 3 to 4 months. So there were not a permanent cure for that. So stem cells, which have been rapidly used in human beings, we have already used it 4 years back and I have stopped using stem cells now because of the same reasons. Stem cells in wound healing work pretty well. But in the orthopedic cases, mainly in dogs, I feel the limitations are very, 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 the application is just for 3 to 4 months. So if your client is ready to do that, there was a special company with which they opened for stem cell treatment in dogs and they had to shut down because when they started itself, I was, we had done already a 3 years research and they started and I told them that this is not going to work out because ultimately this is going to fail because the window is very small window. Even if you are doing, if you're planning to do your research in stem cells in dogs, I'm not discouraging you, but try to look into platelet-rich plasma because I feel platelet-rich plasma is the future.
Should we add anything to platelet-rich plasma? How long we can store it?
Platelet-rich plasma, you can add hyaluronic acid. I don't store it. It's better to use it fresh because fresh cells are always better. If you want to use it, maybe not more than 2 or 3 hours. I like to use hyaluronic acid because hyaluronic acid helps to disperse the stem cells pretty well into the joint, cartilage and rest of the surfaces. And hyaluronic acid also has got a very good viscosity in that. So you can mix hyaluronic acid along with stem cell and use it.
Is there any way of managing vertebral fractures and dysplasia from Dr. Shrikant?
Vertebral fractures by what?
And dysplasia. Is there any way of managing it, vertebral fractures and dysplasia?
Vertebral fractures are managed to be managed by, they can't be managed. You have to treat them by putting, using pedicle screw or plates. I use a lot of pedicle screws. Which are made in India pretty, if you want, you can ask Dr. Kunal from Maxvet. He's got a source who's making very good pedicle screws and they're fantastic in managing vertebral fractures. And you can, the size is very small, so you can use it in small dogs. Recently, I've used in cat in Qatar and the cat was just 6 kilos in size. And the cat is walking pretty well after using it, after stabilizing the fracture.
This would be the last question from Dr. Karma. If there are no surgical options for treating patients with spinal trauma or fractures and hindquarter paralysis with urine and fecal retention, what other means of treatment and rehab would you advise?
These dogs do pretty well on the wheels, in fact. If you get the cart for them, they do pretty well. You can use diapers for them. There is a device which is being invented in the US, which has been used by the neurosurgeons, which helps to stimulate, it's like an electric current which helps to stimulate the bladder. And then the bladder starts, you have to switch it on to program it. And once the bladder, and then you know the frequency of urination, if the bladder is full, you can just start using that device and it gives like an electric current and stimulates the bladder to evacuate. So it's another level of surgery which is required. But I tell the owner to do manual mole of the urine by pressing the bladder. And most of the owners do it pretty well. I've seen 4 to 5 dogs which are completely paralyzed, hind limb paralysis, and every day the evacuation of urine. And basically, if you don't evacuate the urine will flow out and there will be a lot of scalding of the tissue. So these dogs need treatment or timely evacuation of urine. If you do the evacuation of urine very well, and when you evacuate the urine, they also pass the feces. So they do pretty well with the diapers and on the cart. And they have to move on the cart at least 15 to 20 minutes every day morning and evening just to regenerate the energy level. These dogs have very high energy stored, so they start moving on their front leg frequently if you don't take them for a walk on the cart. So you can buy carts online, or if you have a small cat or dog, you can make your own carts. I recently made a cart for a dog in Qatar with a spinal trauma, with just for out of PVC pipe, and bought some wheels from hardware store. And there are nice YouTube videos you can see and make your own cart.
One last question, sir. It is from Dr. Kumarasan. Can we use steroid and dimethyl sulfoxide for osteoarthritis?
DMSO is used in horses. I don't have any experience. I use DMSO only for open wounds or intra wounds which are in the paws, basically. DMSO works pretty well. It has got a fantastic healing. So I never used, and I've never read any paper on DMSO. They use IV in horses. So I've never read a paper on DMSO on injecting either intra-articularly or intravenous in this. But locally, yes, I use it. And steroid, in what was he asking for? Steroid for what?
Osteoarthritis.
Yes. Steroid has very limited application in osteoarthritis. So if it is a very bad day, not managed by your painkillers, steroid is for long-term therapy. Steroid is not the answer for long-term therapy, because steroid has their own side effects. If you use in long-term, your dog will end up into obesity, and long-term steroid use also deteriorates the cartilage quality. The cartilage quality get deteriorated. So never use steroid in long-term this, unless until you can just use it once. I use depomedrol in patients which need a quick relief from osteogenic pain. And we if it's too painful and you can't manage with carprofen or any other pain remedies, and just for quick relief, you can use a long-acting depomedrol where it will act for 7 to 8 days, and the pain management is better. Then you later on try to manage into with non-steroidal anti-inflammatory. But never use non-steroidal anti-inflammatory. I still see a lot of people using non-steroidal anti-inflammatory along with the steroids, and then the dog start bleeding. And never advise your client to give painkiller over a phone, because they'll eventually give Brufen, which is not advisable in dogs at all, because they have bleeding. Then they use a lot of other human painkillers like I'm not getting the name, but
which Brufen is carpal tryptophan. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So this will cause gastrointestinal bleeding. So don't advise. And plus, in cats, never advise paracetamol as a painkiller, because you are going to kill that cat with paracetamol. I think that's it. Let me finish this. Thank you for Bettina. Thank you. That Bettina team did a fantastic job, and keep on doing good work as you are doing it. And all the best. And thank you for all the participants who have attended. And yes, we'll take it further, say goodbye and see you next time for another new
yes. venture. Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. Yes, it's sir. A wonderful association yeah. with you since the day one. And we are always getting benefited of your knowledge, and certainly it can be shared with a multiple of people in a multiple occasions. Yeah. So it's wonderful to be with you always. And thank you so much to be part of this webinar.
Yes, sir.
And share your knowledge with all the people. Yeah. So we'll be conducting many more such webinars yeah. with you, and we'll share your knowledge with most of the people in India. So thank Great. You. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you very much. Alias. Bye-bye.
Thank you so much, Dr. Sharu, to be a part of this webinar.
Thank you. Thank you for sharing your
information.
It was a pleasure.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. I thank all the wonderful participants for being a part of this webinar. With this, I announce that the webinar is over. Thank you. Have a great evening. Yes.
Kiran, thank you so much to be part of this webinar since morning to evening. Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Bye.
Bye-bye. Okay, Seema, bye.
Bye-bye. Good night.